Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Don't Quit Your Day Job, the 6 Mind Shifts You Need to Rise and Thrive at Work, by Aliza Knox with Wendy Paris, narrated by Carla Kissane. Letter to the Listener. If you have a job or are seeking one, this book is for you. While the conversation in the media or even at a dinner party might be about entrepreneurship or exploiting your side hustle or the great resignation, the day-to-day reality is that most of us work for someone else and increasingly in large organizations. We also work for decades, which may sound daunting and exhausting, but as you'll see in this book, plenty of people find ways to make work rewarding, fulfilling, and dare I say, fun. Across the globe, an increasing percentage of people work for large companies. In the UK alone, nearly half of the workers are employed by firms with 250 people or more. In the US, as of the 2014 census data, nearly 40% of workers were employed at either large companies, those with 2,500 people or more, or very large ones, with 10,000 people or more. Close to another third of workers in the US were at mid-sized companies, with 100 to 2,500 employees. As corporations and businesses continue to grow, so will opportunities within them. What you need to succeed are the 6 mind shifts laid out as chapters in this book. The mind shifts are outlined, then brought to life with relatable examples of people I've met along the way. All of these people are real, though some names and occasionally some genders have been changed, as they used to say on TV, to protect the innocent. Ways to put the mind shifts into practice are listed at the end of each chapter, so you can adopt the ones that work for you. If my life had worked out differently, I might have been a forester, planting trees, assembling timber plots, and writing about it all in a rough-hewn log cabin surrounded by towering redwoods, with the occasional bear ambling by. This wasn't actually a dream of mine as a child. Growing up in the US, I had no specific vision of what my career would be. I worked odd jobs to earn and save money in high school, and one of these jobs involved taking aptitude and personality tests at Stanford University's Graduate School of Education. One test indicated that I'd be well suited to a life in forestry or the clergy. Neither option, I confess, interested me remotely. I wasn't really exposed to people working within large corporations, and I never particularly thought about corporate life either. I've now spent the past 40 years working for and leading businesses at some of the world's most interesting, innovative companies, including more than a decade heading the Asia-Pacific region, APAC, for parts of Google as well as for Twitter and Cloudflare. Before that, I served as the first female partner in Asia at Boston Consulting Group, BCG. Over the years, I also had roles in the financial services sector, including at Visa, American Express, and Charles Schwab. I went to Brown University, where you didn't have to declare a major until your junior year, which was one reason I chose the school. After graduating with a degree in applied math and economics, I took a job in banking because it ticked 2 boxes on my wish list: a great training program and the opportunity to move to New York City, which seemed like an exciting place to live. While much of my career has been in sales and general management, these were not early interests. As a teen, I subscribed to 17 magazine, typical, and Psychology Today, oddball choice, thinking that maybe I'd become a psychologist. I had exactly 1 early experience in sales, creating an ad book with 3 friends in high school to fund our senior year activities. I had to go to dozens of merchants I didn't know and ask for money to advertise to the students and parents. It was my idea, and I persisted with it. Looking back now, that is the real through line in my career: perseverance. Once I decide on something, I'm full steam ahead, driven to make it happen. Recently, My mom said that even in high school, I was always tired because I was trying to cram in one more thing. It's easy to feel like you should know exactly what you want to do in your career in order to be successful and happy, to have a specific vision and then execute it. But that hasn't been my path, or that of many of the people in this book. The fact is, you don't have to know what you want to do to rise and thrive, and even if you do know now, you may change your mind later. Today's rapid pace of change means that many of the most exciting fields and companies of the future probably don't exist now. Even if you love what you're doing, something else might arise that intrigues you, as the internet did for me in my 40s. Even though I didn't have a specific plan in mind, other than travel, I knew I wanted to travel, I did have drive, curiosity, and a desire to connect and help out. These traits have helped me, and embracing them can help you too. People who look at my career from the outside and see me as super successful sometimes conclude that success must mean never failing. But this isn't true either. While I love helping build businesses and am proud of my achievements, I've also had my share of missteps, including twice taking jobs that I quickly regretted and left in less than a year. I've been laid off. Once my department was dissolved and I had to let go of my whole team and then leave myself. Success doesn't require an early, clear-cut vision, nor does it come from never having setbacks. Rather, it grows from working hard and adopting some crucial mindsets, or mind shifts, attitudes you can learn and put into practice. Over the past 40 years, I've come to identify 6 essential mind shifts made by those who succeed, 6 powerful attitudes and actions that underpin organizational success. I have watched people thrive using these mindsets. I've also seen other very smart, talented people fail to flourish because they didn't embrace them. These are the mindsets I want to share with you in this book. Success means something different to different people, of course. For you, it might mean achieving a certain lifestyle or rising to a desired position or reputation within an industry. It could mean fame and fortune, influence, making a difference, helping others, or supporting a family comfortably. In my own life, success has meant having the lifestyle I want, achieving financial comfort sufficient for my family and some charitable giving, and rising to reasonably high positions, though not CEO. But I do also have a universal view of success, which includes having some sense of control over your life, feeling of agency in your career, and liking, for the most part, how you spend your time, who you spend it with, and how much you're earning. This is the view of success that this book can help you achieve. I've also had a not-so-secret sideline occupation as a mentor maven, an unofficial, unpaid career coach and supporter for hundreds of people at all stages of their working lives. Over the decades, I have listened to and advised people negotiating promotions and setbacks, struggling to rise and preserve time with their families, hoping to move overseas or return home, deciding whether to accept an offer or keep looking, and strategizing about how to fight back when wronged. The stories of some of these mentees are in this book too. Helping other people develop has been the most fulfilling activity of my life, besides raising my own kids. Maybe having lacked the coordination or popularity required to be a cheerleader in high school left me with a desire to cheer on people in the career arena. Mentoring and advising people has brought me tremendous pride and enabled me to gain more pleasure from working. If I didn't work, I wouldn't be able to help these people or forge these connections. Sometimes people reach out for advice because I've long been one of the few female sales executives in the hard-scrabble tech business. Others seek input because I'm older and have survived. Or because I'm more approachable than Tony Robbins or a celebrity CEO. People want to know how to find time to raise children and travel regularly for work, how to manage setbacks without letting them sap confidence and derail goals. This is another reason I'm writing this book, to take this mentoring to more people, to share with you what those I've mentored have learned. After so many years in tech, I now see my career as a series of software upgrades. Aliza 1.0 was consulting and financial services. 2.0 was tech. What you're holding in your hands now is part of Aliza 3.0, the third iteration of my working life. I'm still experimenting with what I want to do, and this book is part of this third phase. It's a way to continue my greatest work passion, sharing lessons learned from decades of leading US companies across new frontiers while building and maintaining strong connections between teams around the world. In a world where remote workforce defines more of us than ever before, this background allows me to offer insight and wisdom as a leader who has been in charge of far-flung workforces for years. In many ways, now is the best time ever to be looking for a job or seeking a better one. It seems like you can't read the news without seeing an article about how much work is changing, both the structure within offices and what people want and expect from their jobs. We are in a moment of real dynamism at work. Companies that once required everyone to be physically present at headquarters or in one of their offices around the globe are going remote or adopting hybrid models. Employees who never had the flexibility to work from home are now considering it or even making it a condition of employment. COVID-19 has forced, or allowed, people to reevaluate their careers and values, their trajectory, and even what a career path means for them. Nobel Prize winner and New York Times columnist Paul Krugman summed up the general sentiment. It seems quite possible that the pandemic, by upending many Americans' lives, also caused some of them to reconsider their life choices. In many fields, employers are scrambling to fill roles. The demand for workers affects everything from salary and bonuses to in-office perks, flexible work arrangements, and even time off. This gives would-be employees leverage that didn't exist for most of my time at work. Additionally, corporations, non-profits, government agencies, and universities are investing resources in expanding the diversity of job candidates, employees, and leaders, and rightly so. This opens exciting opportunities for many people who may have felt shut out of top jobs in the past and is leading to an improved workplace. Diversity also boosts the bottom line, an undeniable motivator for firms. Take gender diversity as one example. A Peterson Institute for International Economics survey of nearly 20,000 firms operating in 91 countries found a repeated, demonstrable correlation between women at the C-suite level and higher profitability. And the magnitude of the estimated effects is not small. For example, a profitable firm at which 30% of leaders are women could expect to add more than 1 percentage point to its net margin compared with an otherwise similar firm with no female leaders. Even if, in your own life, you've experienced the push for diversity as more talk than action, a more diverse workforce is absolutely the direction of the future. Career success increasingly depends on working well with others within an organization. For me, this book could also be called How to Succeed in Business by Being Your Best Self. It describes a way of rising in your career that hinges on exhibiting the attributes we ascribe to being a good person, colleague, and friend, being reliable and trustworthy, encouraging of others, and making time for yourself. This advice comes not only from my work experience, but also from my deep belief in the value of caring about others while also advocating for yourself, of seeing the world as full of opportunities, not a zero-sum game, the options plentiful, not scarce. You can thrive in your career without adopting a narrow-eyed, cutthroat, winner-take-all approach. Yes, work is highly competitive, and you can't expect anyone else to look out for you but you. A career is not a family. Your boss doesn't love you like a good parent and may not even like you. Your boss doesn't have to be your friend, but they do need to value the work you're doing and respect your contribution. There certainly are people who are jerks and succeed. They have personal goals and they go after them. If they step on a few people along the way, that doesn't deter them. Nasty people can do well in business. As much as I'd like to believe that the people who climb on others are miserable at home, they may not be. Some may even be happy with their lives. But this overly self-focused approach to success is not mine and not the vision of this book. It is, however, one reason you need stamina, which I cover in Chapter 2. Part of thriving is surviving, including being able to process unfairness and refocus on your own path. The strategy in this book is not about using others to get ahead. This is not Sun Tzu's The Art of War, nor Machiavelli's The Prince. It's an approach that involves being open and enthusiastic about work and those around you, learning the power structure within your place of business, making sure you find supporters at work and outside of your job, and being a mentor and supporter for those coming up after you. It's about making a choice and throwing yourself into it, getting out of a role or company if it becomes clear that you can't get ahead within it, and being flexible about your dreams. It advocates being open to the serendipity around you, the people you meet, and the personal passions that are part of a full life. This book could also perhaps be called Getting In and Staying In. So many of these mindsets require stamina, and while Chapter 2 focuses specifically on this attribute, as you'll see, a long, rewarding career requires being able to deal with setbacks, to refocus, and continue to do what's needed to thrive. The six mindshifts, in brief. I see the mindshifts in this book as timeless. They are based on my 40 years of work and of listening to and guiding people at all stages of their careers, from recent college grads to mid-career professionals to leaders within Fortune 100 firms. It includes my stories and those of numerous people who represent a wide range of backgrounds and professions. Each chapter ends with specific takeaways you can apply in your own life. The world of work is always changing, but these essential mind shifts remain the same. Organizational life is appreciably better now for many than in the recent past. Piruze, who you meet in Chapter 1, is an example of how people today are endeavoring to improve the work environment and winning. She focused on doing an excellent job at work and at home, and designing a role that would not mean forfeiting the time she needed in either realm. As she discovered, thriving in both worlds is easier if you are very clear about what you want, present your desires to your boss professionally and clearly, backed by data if you can find it, and remain flexible and willing to work with the firm to make it a success for everyone. Stamina is a career superpower, and as I explain in Chapter 2, stamina can be built. One important mindset to help build stamina: don't overfocus on the negative. Another: remember that you have options. As Maria Breeze discovered when she did some job dating to see what other options might exist, her skills and experience were far more valuable in the marketplace than she knew. In Chapter 3, you will meet Rahul and learn why I offered him a job while we were walking through a revolving door together in Beijing. Hint: we formed a bond while travelling. You will learn that connections with peers and leaders can be as significant as work performance when it comes to rising and thriving, and that arguably the most important capital you can accrue in business is not financial capital, but social capital. Yet another story, of a man I call Bo, in Chapter 4, shows in some cases how much things haven't changed in the world of work, despite today's focus on employee satisfaction, hybrid teams, and diversity. You still will likely have experiences of being treated unfairly, and you have to fight back when you're wronged. No, this does not have to mean taking a firm to court, or even being rehired after an unjust termination, but it does mean standing up for yourself in a way that will let you move forward and preserve your good relationship with your career. In Chapter 5, you will learn about how people are using movement to rise and thrive, not only moving up, as in preparing for and getting promotions, but also moving from one field to another and between firms, industries, and sectors. You'll also learn how to create movement where you are through job crafting, which a man I call Tim has done to redesign his current job to include more challenges and creative growth, culminating in higher job satisfaction. And in Chapter 6, you will find out how Sierra's request to move to a company's overseas office expanded her professional opportunities and enhanced her personal life, even though she didn't wind up heading to her first dream destination. Like Sierra, your desire to move overseas can be a benefit to your company. Understanding and embracing the truly global nature of work today is key to succeeding and making the kinds of connections that help work feel meaningful. We are all standing together at a unique, historic inflection point, a moment in which our beliefs about the future of work are shifting as rapidly as the technology we're using to make it happen. This change is exciting and challenging, and it requires a strong set of tools and a new outlook to succeed. This book is that toolbox. Thank you for opening it and being part of the conversation. Here's to rising and thriving into the future, whatever it may bring. Mindshift 1. Go for both. Your work and your life are on the same team. Power perspectives in this chapter. Embrace non-work passions. Make work fun. Don't agonize over decisions, as there are very few truly wrong ones. See the serendipity and act on it. In 2007, after more than 2 decades of working in financial services and consulting, a journey that took me from Bankers Trust in New York City to BCG in Sydney and Singapore, and then to Charles Schwab and Visa in California, I did something radical. I made a mid-career switch that was risky. I took a lower title and a pay cut to move into a new industry that I didn't know much about, technology. I moved to Google to run APAC online sales, followed by leadership roles at Twitter and, most recently, Cloudflare, an internet security company. Not long after I landed the job at Google, I travelled from my then home in San Francisco to Sydney to introduce myself to the Australian team. While in Sydney, I met a young American woman named Susie Nicoletti. Susie was at the beginning of her career and was bright and energetic. She seemed right at home in outdoorsy Sydney. We immediately bonded over a conversation about swimming. It's kind of impossible not to talk about the water in Sydney, a harbour city with beaches. Susie had been a competitive swimmer in college in Los Angeles. I'm also an avid swimmer, though not at the collegiate level. We also talked about our favourite American foods that are unavailable in Asia. Stovetop stuffing, Susie. Diet Dr. Pepper, me. Chatting about non-work interests like these helps reveal the human side of colleagues and of yourself, making it a valuable part of having a career you love, because it helps you create a work community filled with people you care about. Over the next few years, Susie would reach out occasionally to check in and update me about her career progress and goals. This is often how I become a mentor to someone. We'll meet through work or socially and take the time to connect. Over time, Susie began expressing a desire to step into a larger leadership role. After 5 years at Google, I left to take another Singapore-based position, building APAC for Twitter. I needed someone to fill an important role running mid-market sales and operations in Australia. this would be a great opportunity for Susie Nicoletti. The job had a lot of responsibility and would be a big promotion aligned with her career goals. I was excited to offer her the position. But when I did, she turned me down. How was this possible? How could she say no to a great role, and one that would let her work for a great boss, as in me, I might add? She wanted to have kids, she told me. From everything she'd heard about the demands of corporate leadership and of caring for a baby, she couldn't do both. She had to pick one or the other. Also, she wasn't sure she could handle the job. I knew she could do the work, and that she could be a good leader and a great parent. I did not buy the idea that you could only have one or the other. I still don't, and I told her so. I've never subscribed to that either-or limiting view, and I often feel like it's part of my personal mission to help others see beyond it. Not everyone wants a family, but I do believe everyone can have a great career and a fulfilling personal life. During several calls, I tried to steer Susie toward taking the job. How could she give up before trying? Why let her desire to have a family slow her professional growth? During a turning point conversation over lattes at a beach cafe in Sydney, she finally agreed to give it a shot. She thrived in the position, and she had her baby. She went on to have a second child while still in that role. Within 3 years, she landed another promotion, this time as the Managing Director of Twitter, Australia and New Zealand. I'm happy to report that her career and now 3 children are all doing well. The aha of Susie's story. Step off the seesaw of work-life balance. So many people I've met believe they'll come to an either-or moment in their careers as Susie did, a time when one of their most important desires will have to give way. They ask, isn't it impossible to have a great career and a really fulfilling home life? Don't I have to sacrifice one for the other? No, you don't. Not in my experience, or in the experience of hundreds of people I've met and advised over the years. Yes, there are a lot of difficulties when you're trying to raise children and hold down a career, or practice your profession and pursue sport at a national level, or work and be a full-time carer. It can be quite hard, and the difficulties the media points out are real. There are trade-offs to be made, of course. You might not get as much sleep as you'd like all the time. Your house might not be as consistently clean as you wish. Your wardrobe might not be particularly stylish. I'm talking about myself here. You might push some limits occasionally, like flying from Singapore to Thailand for a meeting in a huge raincoat to hide from the airline rule-bound flight attendants just how pregnant you are. Yes, me again. It can be expensive to manage with a modicum of calm. My husband and I definitely spent way more than we'd planned, or thought we could, on childcare to accommodate both of our careers, and not everyone can afford that option. Still, I've seen so many women and men rise in the corporate world, non-profit arena, government or academia, while also having a full life outside of it, whether that means building a family or pursuing another personal passion. New Zealand's Prime Minister, Jacinda Ardern, is an inspiring, high-profile example of going for both. She had a baby while in office in 2018, and her partner, Clark Gayford, stayed home to care for the baby. As she put it, "I am not the first woman to multitask. I am not the first woman to work and have a baby. There are many women who have done this before." This helps send an important message. We can pursue our goals at work and outside of it. In fact, Prime Minister Ardern is the second elected head of government to give birth in office after Pakistan's late Prime Minister Benazir Bhutto. As Helen Clark, the former New Zealand Prime Minister and former head of the UN Development Programme, put it, "For young women, the example Ardern is setting is an affirmation that they too can expect to have that choice." In my own life, I have been able to hold leadership positions and do the things that are important to me, rise in my career from an entry-level position at a bank in New York to leading teams distributed across Asia from Singapore for some of the top tech firms in the world, and also have a lot of fun with my husband, raise two sons, belong to three book groups, exercise and volunteer. We've all heard the phrase work-life balance. It sounds like a good goal, yet this formula suggests that work and life are at odds with each other, on opposite ends of a seesaw. One must be down for the other to be up. But our lives are not seesaws. They're more like cars, and we all want wheels filled to ensure a smooth, satisfying ride. We need to shift away from the constricting adversarial model of your work or your life and embrace a more expansive, inclusive, flexible vision. We can establish goals and drive toward them in all areas of our lives. For some people, an expansive view includes not being tied to a specific job or title. Simon Cantor, a London-based married father of two, has worked for a consultancy, the British government, tech and communication firms, most recently as the chief operating officer, and today is at Egon Zehnder, one of the top executive search firms in the world. While he's had high-powered, rewarding roles, he has structured his career to support his life as a whole and his family. Some people let their jobs define them, but for a lot of people, that's not the case. I don't define myself as a recruiter. I'm a father, a friend, a husband, a son. If I can add trusted advisor, I want to be that too. Simon takes something of a historical perspective to the question of the role of work. He sees himself as lucky in general to be able to pursue various opportunities and to craft a life that he loves. I'm living a life my ancestors couldn't imagine, he says. To me, having health, good fortune and family is what matters. The work makes that possible. For more on Simon's varied career moves, see Chapter 5. Anne-Marie Slaughter, CEO of the Washington, D.C.-based think tank New America and author of several books, has written about how she realized that success in multiple domains can depend on paying attention to the specifics of each. Slaughter was working as the Dean of Princeton University's Woodrow Wilson School of Public and International Affairs, living in New Jersey and raising two sons with her husband. In 2009, she took a two-year public service leave from the university for an incredibly prestigious and time-consuming position in Washington, D.C., as the first female director of policy planning in the U.S. State Department. This is one of the highest jobs in the State Department, and it comes with huge responsibility and amazing opportunities. For Slaughter, it also came with having to leave her house to catch the 5:30 a.m. train to D.C. every Monday and being away from home until late Friday night. Despite the amazing opportunities the job afforded, after 2 years, she decided it wasn't the right role. Given her other life goals, which included being physically present for her two teenage sons at a time when they really needed her, she returned to Princeton, a decision made partly due to this realization and partly due to Princeton's policies around how long a professor can be absent before losing tenure, 2 years. I realized having it all, at least for me, depended almost entirely on what type of job I had, she writes. Back in Princeton, Slaughter continued with a busy, high-powered career of teaching, writing, giving speeches, and doing TV appearances. Still, as she writes in a now-famous Atlantic article about the experience, some women her age and older were quick to label her decision as giving up, as being stymied by the impossibility of achieving work-life balance. Implicit in their response was the belief that something must give, either career or personal life. In her own view, as I see it, she had made a choice aligned with all her values. Slaughter believes that having more women in leadership positions will help improve well-being for women, as will the increased ability to work from home, something the pandemic has clearly accelerated. As she puts it, only when women wield power in sufficient numbers will we create a society that genuinely works for all women, That will be a society that works for everyone. As I've witnessed among younger people I mentor, many women and men are pushing for more flexible work schedules and better jobs, and succeeding in these efforts. One example is a woman named Peruze. Negotiating for what you need. Peruze grew up in Turkey, studied in the US, and built an impressive international career as a startup founder, consultant, and then as a division leader. In her early 30s, she was living in Singapore and building the Southeast Asia business for a fintech company. Peruze spent more than 5 years at this fast-paced company, having gone from being the first person on the ground in the region to being in an office with 150 people. She decided to take a sabbatical to focus on learning, pushing herself in areas she couldn't find the time to explore between a demanding job and a family. It might have seemed like a risky move, but she was confident she could do it and get back in again. During her sabbatical, she got pregnant and then started looking for a new job. She got a terrific offer to join a venture capital firm as a partner. This offer came while she was 12 weeks pregnant with her second child. The fact that her would-be new boss wanted to hire her, knowing full well that she'd be up for 4 months of maternity leave soon, speaks to the real changes happening at some firms in terms of valuing good employees and working to accommodate their whole lives. As she was preparing to head back after maternity leave, she gave a lot of thought to how she could do an excellent job and still have enough time with her newborn. She decided to ask for a 4-day work week as she started back. She presented it as a trial to see if it would work and brought in data. I didn't just say, I want this and I want that. I said, hey, I talked to some people that I look up to, who are in my situation. This is the best practice that the best firms are doing now.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.